We knew that the James Webb Space Telescope would find interesting stuff, especially about the mysterious early epoch of the universe. For example, there are hints that the galaxies we're seeing there are brighter and more regular than expected given the short amount of time they'd had to grow. But perhaps no one was expecting that we would find a completely new type of star, one powered by dark matter and shining as bright as an entire galaxy, which, by the way, might help us explain those pesky giant galaxies. In April, a paper was published in Nature Astronomy reporting the observation of four objects, JADES GS-Z10-0 through JADES GS-Z13-0. We'll call these Z10 through Z13 for short. Not very poetic, but space is so big we ran out of cool names decades ago. Admittedly, these don't look all that impressive. They're basically just dots, but that's true of anything too far away to properly resolve. So you'll have to trust me and be impressed anyway. Why? Because these are among the oldest and most distant objects ever seen. Z13 and Z12 actually are the current second and third placeholders for the most distant objects whose distances are actually confirmed, with Z11 a respectable fifth place. They were discovered as part of the JWST Advanced Deep Extragalactic Survey, or JADES, whose mission is to study the very first galaxies that formed in our universe. This is only possible with JWST because of its incredible sensitivity to the infrared. It can see stars whose energetic ultraviolet and visible light has been stretched far into infrared wavelengths as it travelled to us through an expanding universe. Some of these things are over 30 billion light years away, meaning that their light has been travelling to us for most of the age of the universe. We're looking at the cosmos as it was only around 400 million years after the Big Bang, or around 3% or less of its current age. Based on the brightness of these blobs, at first glance it seems they must be entire galaxies, but enormous ones at some hundreds of millions of times the mass of the Sun. Such big galaxies are common enough in the modern universe, but no one expected to find galaxies so big back then when they'd had so little time to form. The issue with the big early galaxies discovered by JWST has caused a lot of consternation and some pretty out there speculation. That said, let's at least entertain the hypothesis that we are looking at something truly weird here. After all, these are the cosmic dark ages that we're peering into, a time when the ocean of pristine hydrogen forged in the Big Bang shrouded our vision across much of the electromagnetic spectrum. It's a time when that same pristine hydrogen was able to form stars many thousands of times more massive than today. Who knows what else might be lurking out there at the edge of our map? Perhaps here be dragons. Or perhaps here be dark stars. That's the assertion of another new paper that was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, the idea that three of these four objects might be powered by dark matter. The original idea for dark stars was proposed by Catherine Fries and collaborators back in 2007, but this is the first time that we've seen candidates for these objects. I should point out that the term dark star was originally used by John Mitchell back in 1783 to describe a very early incarnation of the black hole. But these new dark stars aren't that. They aren't even dark. They are super bright. But how can dark matter, which is meant not to interact with light at all, produce so much of the stuff? Before we build our own dark star, we're going to need a particular type of dark matter. For example, it doesn't work if dark matter is made up of mini black holes or failed stars. It has to be some new kind of undiscovered particle. And even then, there are a few rules the particle has to follow to be able to make a dark star. First, it has to obey the main rule of all dark matter. It can't interact strongly with itself. That means one dark matter particle can't easily bounce off another without getting super close. That enables dark matter to avoid collapsing easily under its own gravity, which is needed to explain how it remains as a giant puffy cloud surrounding nearly all galaxies. On the other hand, particles in a cloud of gas strongly interact with each other, generating a kind of internal friction that saps kinetic energy from that gas and allows the cloud to shrink, to form stars. But with very little self-interaction, dark matter stays puffy. One type of strong interaction that is doubly ruled out is the electromagnetic interaction. Dark matter can't emit or absorb photons, and we need that for dark matter to remain dark. The second rule for making dark stars is that while the dark matter particle can't interact strongly with itself, it does have to have at least some weak self-interaction. This interaction's strength has to be tuned so that when the cloud is large, it experiences almost no interaction due to the particles being so far apart. But if we can get those dark matter particles close enough together, they will interact. This allows the dark matter cloud to finally collapse, just like a gas cloud, but only under certain extreme circumstances. But more importantly, it allows the dark matter to annihilate. And that's the last requirement. For our dark matter particles to form dark stars, they have to be able to annihilate each other. This could mean the particle is its own antiparticle, allowing any two particles to self-annihilate if they get too close. That's the assumption in the recent paper. But this could also work if dark matter comes in particle-antiparticle pairs. The key is that the annihilation happens when the particles get close enough together. Now that we know what type of dark matter we need, let's assume that's the type that actually exists in the universe. This isn't unreasonable. Popular candidates for dark matter, like WIMPs for example, should fit these requirements. So, we're going to fill our early universe with lots of dark matter, smeared out pretty evenly across all of space. We'll also add some hydrogen and helium at about a fifth the quantity of dark matter. And finally, we have some small fluctuations in the density of all that matter, regions of higher density that would pull on the surrounding material and so seed the first structures in the universe. The seeds of the first giant stars would have been so-called mini-halos, with masses of millions to hundreds of millions of times the Sun's mass. The dark matter part would have a hard time collapsing due to being weakly interacting. However, the gas in that halo would fall towards the center, perhaps en route to building a star, depending on how large this halo was. Now, as we discussed in our recent episode, dark matter can be strongly influenced by the gravitational pull of regular matter. And that's what happens here. The growing density of gas in the center of the halo would drag some of the dark matter inwards. The density of dark matter inside the central ball of gas would rise to much higher levels than is seen in the modern universe. And this is where our dark star is born. The amount of dark matter inside the star is relatively low, only a fraction of a percent of the mass of gas. But its concentration is trillions of times higher than the dark matter in a typical galaxy. That means its particles can find each other. And remember what happens then? They annihilate, releasing an enormous amount of energy in the process. In this case, mostly in the form of very fast-moving decay products. That energy release heats up the surrounding gas and actually stops it from contracting any further. The gas ball never gets dense enough to form a true star, but that doesn't matter, because the dark matter annihilation is producing far more energy than a regular star ever could. Our newborn dark star starts out as a bloated ball a few times Earth's orbital radius and several times the mass of the Sun. But then it grows, pulling more gas and dark matter from the rich material of the surrounding young universe. It grows in size several times, perhaps to the size of Saturn's orbit, and it may grow to millions of times the mass of the Sun. At that size, it's glowing billions of times brighter than the Sun, bright enough to be seen by JWST at the ends of the universe. Okay, let's assume for a moment that dark stars once existed. What happened to them? Eventually, that dark matter would annihilate enough of itself that it could no longer support the gas cloud from collapsing. However, it's also possible that a dark star could replenish its supply of fuel by pulling in dark matter from the surrounding halo. Either way, when it's done, be it millions or even billions of years, once the gas is no longer supported, it would probably collapse pretty quickly into a black hole. This is actually a nice feature of this hypothesis. We know there are giant black holes in the centers of most galaxies, and those black holes seem to have grown very quickly in the early universe. Perhaps dark stars give us a way to produce the seed black holes with a million suns worth of mass that could then grow into the billion solar mass monsters that we see in the very first quasars shining out of the early universe. So, are dark stars one of these wild speculations that are almost impossible to verify or refute? Fortunately, not. There are some pretty straightforward observations that could distinguish a dark star from a massive early galaxy. We can do that from the signature wavelengths of light that are absorbed or emitted by gas in whatever these objects are. When we split the light of a star into component wavelengths, what we call a spectrum, we see that there are chunks taken out of the spectrum at specific wavelengths. These are absorption lines and happen because the bright light from deep in the star gets absorbed at very particular wavelengths by atoms near the surface. On the other hand, a galaxy spectrum tends to show what we call emission lines. This is light from cold gas in between the stars that's been illuminated by the surrounding starlight. It gives the colours that you might be familiar with in these beautiful images of nebulae. Now, if we can get high-quality spectra of these objects, the presence of particular emission lines indicates a galaxy, but if there are no emission lines and we see absorption lines, that would suggest a single star. And with that crazy luminosity, the dark star would be a strong contender for our explanation. Of course, it could be a mix, a small galaxy with a dark star at its center, but hopefully the spectra would help identify that case too. Of course, those distant blobs might just be galaxies, albeit very weird ones. For a very clear take on these supposedly giant galaxies, as well as a takedown of some of the hype, check out Dr. Becky's episodes on the subject. Okay, so what do we have, dark stars or galaxies? Well, galaxies seems more likely, if only because we know galaxies exist, but dark stars are still so speculative. But this is an exciting case where we have a new and kind of strange observation, and there are clear observations that we can make that'll teach us more. Whether or not these things turn out to be dark stars, we are guaranteed to learn more about the mysterious epoch when the very first stars, dark or light, lit up the dawn of space-time. Before we get to comments, we are excited to tell you that PBS has a new slate of science shows coming to PBS Terra. One new exciting one is Human Footprint, in which biologist Shane Campbell-Staton explores how the natural world is adapting to us. The first episode explores how we humans are changing the course of elephant evolution in some very unexpected ways. So, if you'd enjoy a unique scientific understanding of how the world is changing, or if you just like elephants, there's a link in the description. Also consider subscribing to Terra if you want to explore a variety of unique science shows. Today, we're catching up on comment responses for the last three episodes. We have the one about the possibility that the speed of light is variable, then the one about the recent detection of the gravitational wave background with the pulsar timing array, and finally the one where we asked whether the standard model that astrophysicists use for dark matter needs to be revised. Starting with the variable speed of light though. Spin-64 asked whether a rapid decrease in the speed of light over time would be the same thing as a dramatic increase in distance. So, it is possible to model the apparent expansion of the universe as a slowing of the speed of light between the galaxies, and people have tried. In fact, Robert Dickey tried to model this and in fact model all of gravity in terms of a variable speed of light. But this approach doesn't explain all of the effects of general relativity. The warpable, stretchable space-time fabric, on the other hand, does a much more consistent job. Will Dye asks whether the one-way speed of causality changes wildly, perhaps choosing all possible speeds just as a particle chooses all possible paths. Well, Will, this what-if is a reasonable statement of exactly the Feynman path integral approach to calculating the trajectories of quantum particles. And in this picture, which does apply to light, light travels many paths with many speeds between points. But when you sum these up, they cancel out, leaving only the most probable paths, which are those close to a straight line and traveling close to light speed, or within the Heisenberg uncertainty limit of such. Okay, onto the gravitational wave background. Pseudoboat asks whether the pulsar timing array data is public. Well, the answer is yes. Google Nanograv data release and you'll find a download link for the 12.5-year data release and also a link to the paper describing that release so you know what to do with it. But seriously guys, unless you are really planning to do something with it, please don't spam their server too much. Ambles Jambles asks whether gravitational waves can be lensed, for example around supermassive black holes right before they merge. So the answer is absolutely, gravitational waves are subject to gravitational lensing. Grav lensing results from changing the shape of the fabric of space-time. Gravitational waves are waves in that same fabric. They have to travel along whatever weird shape space-time finds itself in. That means gravitational waves do get focused by large masses such as galaxies. In fact, some researchers have wondered whether the very large apparent masses observed in LIGO black hole mergers are actually a result of lensing of those waves increasing their intensity, which makes them look like they come from bigger mergers. But this isn't the generally accepted story, however, it's also not impossible. As for whether a merging supermassive black hole lenses its own gravitational waves, well, sorta. Before the merger, the waves emerging from very near the two black holes will encounter a complex gravitational field, and that influences the shape of the emerging gravitational waves, but this isn't the same focusing magnifying effect of a typical gravitational lens. In a related question, Nama92 asks whether gravitational permeability is a thing, and if so, are gravitational waves subject to refraction? So that's a great question. This is basically asking whether gravitational waves always travel at the same speed, light speed, through all space. The way to slow a gravitational wave would be the same way we slow light, pass it through a medium in which the waves are continuously absorbed and then re-emitted in a coherent way. With light, that means passing it through a medium full of electric charge. The charge of gravity is mass, so it's conceivable that a medium with enormous mass charges could slow the wave. I don't know, maybe a cloud of black holes. I'll have to think harder about this, but I did find at least one paper that talks about reflecting millimeter-scale gravitational waves using a superconducting sheet, which supposedly works because the extreme mass movement is possible for electron pairs due to the absence of friction. Now, this would obviously be very handy if you want to check yourself out in a gravitational wave mirror. Okay, finally on to the episode about dark matter. Inujosha asks, given that usually only cold gas can collapse to form stars, and since dark matter is cold, could a dark matter star theoretically exist? Well, the answer is yes, and they're called dark stars, and we're actually about to do an episode on them. But, TLDR, normally dark matter can't form stars because it doesn't interact strongly enough to shed the orbital angular momentum of its particles. That's needed for those orbits to shrink down and reach the high densities needed to start producing energy. Without that interaction, dark matter particles can be cold, but they tend to stay in their giant slow-moving orbits. A3D4E asks, what if dark matter doesn't exist, and the current gravitational model just needs to be revised at scale? Well, this is such a great question that many, many smart scientists have investigated the possibility and are still doing so. But it's seeming more and more likely that dark matter really is some kind of stuff out there rather than just gravity behaving differently than we expect. One big reason for this is that we see dark matter can sometimes be separated from light matter, like in the Bullet Cluster or more recent discoveries of galaxies with very little dark matter. If dark matter was just gravity of regular matter behaving weird, then we'd at least expect it to always be found just where the regular matter is found, and that's not the case. IE above 11D says that if you listen carefully, you can tell that I have been replaced by an AI. Well, I object to the idea that I've been replaced. That implies I was ever meat-based. The evidence to the contrary is abundant. For one thing, how do you think I survived out here in space for so long?